bandoneo, con su resuello teristo, la noche del cristal, de la copa y del bar, y del tiempo que pasó. Yo bebo más, porque esta noche vendrás. Mi corazón te ve, pero habrá de beber mucho, pero mucho más.
Esa. Okay, welcome to Milonga Mascarita, the podcast, where we look at issues and stories and backstories and people and personalities surrounding tango. And I'm Ray Rudowski, the host, and I'm welcoming from Buenos Aires, Argentina, Ariel Varnerin, musician, composer, tango singer, arranger, father, and very good personal friend of mine. Ariel Varnerin, bienvenido.
Hello, how are you? How are you, Ray?
How is Buenos Aires now?
Oh, Buenos Aires is had a very special sky. This is a shiny day, but you know, it's no normal life. We are in quarantine maybe 9 months ago, so yeah. It's a very special situation. You know, right? Buenos Aires is a very special city. Our culture, our people, all days are getting out of home, so it's very hard to get in, at home. It's so hard because obviously we are a very, very special society. We need to be in contact. We are trying to keep our healthy meter, okay? You know, we have not vaccines now. Maybe are arriving in 2 months. So
right. For us,
it's a very special situation.
It's a difficult time for everyone, and we're all in this together. So thank you again. Well, you know, the way that I think you've got a very interesting history, which we're going to talk about, because today's theme is really the cantor del barrio, the neighborhood singer, the tango singer. And what I want to do is maybe get you to share your personal experiences and then talk about them in a wider historical context. But people would know you maybe from your previous work with the duo Fuertes y Varnerin, who were formed in 2003 and traveled around the world. You were a fixture at Milongas in Buenos Aires and Europe. And I'm very proud to say that I was the first and only organizer in Asia to bring you here in Hong Kong, what seems like yesterday, but was actually 6 years ago in 2014. And we launched your second CD in Hong Kong. And that was a very special time. Tell me about Fuertes y Varnerin, who broke up or ended their partnership in 2019 to go their separate ways. But in that time, you and Agustin Fuertes were a very strong team and a great set of musicians. What did Fuertes y Varnerin bring to tango, do you think?
I think that that duo was a very special development, because we met in the high school conservatory of music here in Buenos Aires. So our duet began with a friendship. You know, we don't play together, but when we met to study some things for the conservatory, our meetings endings ever playing tango. Yes, so Agustin and me found very special feeling together, singing, playing, and talking about life, you know, sharing our life. So it was so special, and because these kind of features allowed that we start to play together without ego. Okay, we were in real agreement that we were part of the music, not just two persons. Okay,
right. It was a team. And what did you bring to tango? What do you think your influence was on tango and milongas? Because I'm going to show a clip in a moment, a video. But before I do that, tell me a little bit about your approach to tango and how did you bring Fuertes y Varnerin into the 21st century?
For us was a surprise because we were thinking about the music, not to do it. We never think about to travel around the world with our music. We never thinking, okay, I want to be a famous singer. I want to be, no, never. Just when two people are in love, they never think about the songs. They never think about the house, about the wedding. Just they are living the moment.
Right.
So Agustina and me were living the moment while by time. And maybe, I don't know, when we arrived to Hong Kong, we can't believe that we were playing tango in Hong Kong with you, right? This is so true, you know, this is true. All that happened are coming to us. We never were looking for the world. We never were looking for some special objective, okay?
The world came to you, yeah?
Yes. The things began to happen us, and okay, we just respond to this kind of call, you know.
Let's play a video. This is I'm going to set this up that this is part of a I actually took this video, and this is let me just find it. Because there's so many great videos here. This is I'm going to play a little bit of from Hong Kong. This was just to set this up. This was a concert that I organized at the Foreign Correspondents Club. Let's play a little bit about it, and let's talk a little bit about your approach to tango.
Sentimental debe estar viejas horas. Nunca te escuché tan triste como ahora.
Llegas hasta mí para aumentar mi queja. Si me curro en ti, sabor a cosa vieja.
Vale, sentimental y llego yo durante.
Vuelvo a recordar aquello tiempo de antes.
Una voz muy lejana me acusa en tu canción. Parece sí y envuelve mi emoción. Sé que no es posible seguir.
Oyéndote sin llorar.
Necesito amigo, ¿no ves? Es incertidumbre tenaz que no hace más que conmover y remover mi soledad. Unos ojos verdes de mar.
Más grande que tu
corazón. Y a grande de amar.
Me voy llorando la voz.
Necesito amigo, ¿no ves? Es incertidumbre tenaz
que no hace más
que conmover y remover mi corazón.
How do you feel looking back at this?
A lot of memories are arriving me. So emotional moment to watch this video. And for us, you know, we played together 15 years. So all our first years, like tango singers, for us were so comfortable, because it's not the same to grow up alone or with a very special partner by side, okay?
The idea of a tango duo was quite unique. It's very old, something that comes out of the early 1900s, the 1910s, the 1920s, Carlos Gardel. The orchestra was really formed in the 20s, 30s, and onwards. So what was that thinking when you started to work with Agustin in terms of what does tango mean to you in that context of the duo? Two people playing music instead of an orchestra.
Yeah, it was a very weird situation because Buenos Aires lost this kind of performing maybe 80 or, I don't know, 90 years ago. For the milongueros here in Buenos Aires to allow us in the middle of the hall of the dance floor, playing guitar without amplification, without microphones, very big places. So the people, when we wait for the silence, stand up in the middle of the hall, people are watching us. Okay, what you want to do in the middle of the hall? I want to dance, but you are there. I can't dance. So for us, it was so special because we know that it was a vintage moment, okay? When the duo Fuertes y Varnerin arrived to the Milonga, maybe the 20s or 30s are coming to the Milonga also. It was very old performing, but we young people, because we were so young when we started to sing in the Milonga. So for us, was like a surprise, right? We never think to get this kind of product. We start to sing, and in that time, it was real. I don't know how, but I remember that we start to listen the De Angelis Orchestra with two singers, Dante and Martel. And when we tried for the next time to arrange a song, Agustin was in Mexico and I was here in Buenos Aires. So we chose to arrange La Pastora, the tango song from De Angelis. And I remember that when Agustin were arriving to Buenos Aires again, I go to looking for him in the airport. And when we are coming again to downtown city, we start to sing that song without guitars, just vocal way. And our voices are working so special, so well together.
You had such amazing harmonies. Like I think of the Everly Brothers, you know, the 1950s guitar duo. That I think is again something where sometimes I think McCartney Lennon in some of those harmonies.
No, so special comparison.
Can you share that song, at least your part, for us now?
Which one?
The song, Pastor.
Oh, let me remember.
Viene serpenteando la quebrada, la pastora su bajada y su tarararara, rubia del color de los trigales. Y rumor de manantiales, y su tarararara. Canta como cantan los que ríen en la vida, sueña como sueña los que tienen alegría. Nadie le conoce alguna queja, solo va con sus ovejas,
y su tarara, dara.
Esa. Well, let's kind of move the career forward then. So again, you left the duo. You each went your separate ways. I think you've both been fairly successful and have gone on to different projects. Your current project is working as the tango singer, the soloist with Orquestra Santa Calavera. Tell me about that. And then I'll play a video of that.
Oh, Santa Calavera was...
How did you get involved? Tell me how you got involved and what are you doing now?
Right now we are in holiday.
Okay.
Okay. No, let me explain. We start to work 1 year ago. Okay. November. But we were rehearsing maybe 2 or 3 months. And after that, we have a very special artistic schedule about to play in La Viruta, to play in Salon Canning. I don't know where more places, but after that, the quarantine starts here in Buenos Aires. So all our activities were stopping. We can't meet to rehearsal or just to talk about the situation. So for us was very, very real and hard situation. We wait. It's a very, very special project. We are 10 or 11 people with the technical people. It's a very, very big group. So I think that after four months, we start to meet by Zoom or through Zoom. And we start to talk about the possibilities to meet again to rehearsal. The Buenos Aires city government communicate about the possibilities to rehearsal with some special protocols. So we need to looking for a very big place to maintain our social distance, you know? So when we found this place, we think that, okay, this is our opportunity, guys. We cannot lost this opportunity. Right. So we start to rehearsal again with a lot of fear, with a lot of rules, okay? Because, you know, this pandemic was so real, I think that around the world. So we start to rehearsal again. We found a very special energy in between of us. So when we start, to rehearsal again, some special things start happening. For example, from Mexico, a dancer, an Argentine dancer, contacts us and say, okay, are you ready to record on streaming? We are a new orchestra again. You know, it's not easy for us. We rehearsed just 2 months before quarantine and 1 week after quarantine. And our repertoire is not easy to abort, you know? But okay, give us 1 month. And in 1 month, we prepare that streaming. Obviously, after that, another streaming coming to us from San Francisco, United States. So after that, we could feel some special energy. Okay, we are a new orchestra. We have a lot of energy. We want to play, we want to record. Okay, this is our opportunity. Yes, we can do it. Yes, sure, we can do it. So we start to play live again with audience. Okay, for us, it was so real, okay? I remember that in the first performing, the whole orchestra were so nervous, so
anxious.
Yes, yes. It was so real because we are professional musicians. For us to be on the stage is normal. I mean, it's not normal. It's not the same like the house, but yes, it's normal. But in that first performing was so hard to stand again in front of the audience, you know?
Right, the pressure of being together and having an audience, and then the pressures of thinking about the COVID situation.
Yes.
Really kind of put something in your heads that you had to break out of.
My head in between of memories and thinkings were so stupid, because you can feel that for us to play again in front of the audience was so rare, because, you know, a lot of protocols, the people had a lot of rules to come.
Yes, yes. Performing.
A lot of rules about the temperature, about ID, the ID number.
Registering the names of people coming in.
Yes.
Mask wearing, yeah.
Yes, obviously mask and distance in between of them. A lot of things. So for us, it was so special. So
let's take a look at one of the, I'm going to just call this up as one of the more recent performances of Orquestra Santa Calavera. And this is, tell me just when was this recorded, this performance?
2 months ago.
Two months ago. It says Tango Maya Festival Online Edition, yeah?
Yes.
All right,
yes.
Let's play a little bit about this and let's talk about it after.
I think you're right.
This is you.
Decir que jamás otra mujer podré querer como a vos. La juventud no ha de volver nunca más, y a la ambición ya puedo darle el adiós. Qué tiempo aquel fugaz que pasó, todo el valor de una pasión conocí. Cuánta feliz frase de amor en mujer, que siempre yo sumiso y fiel te creí. Las caricias de tus manos, tus palabras de ventura, dejaron cruel amargura, sin un poco de piedad. Besos falsos de tu boca, juramentos, ambiciones, mataron mis ilusiones en un poco de piedad.
Wow.
Amazing.
Yeah, amazing. Yeah, that was recorded originally by Pugliese with Alberto Moran. Who are your influences as a tango singer? Who do you get inspiration from of the great singers?
The first inspiration was Roberto Goyeneche.
Roberto Goyeneche. Why?
It's so rare. In that time, I'm talking about, I think, 25 years, maybe. I worked in the bank here in Buenos Aires. Yes, I was a musician, but
you worked in a bank. Okay.
Private bank here in Buenos Aires, the most important bank. Yes. But my musician soul ever was so hard in me. So I remember that one morning working on bank, worker of the bank sent me, Ariel, you like tango, no? Yes, I like, but I'm a rock singer, you know? Oh, yes. Ah, but you must listen. Okay, yes. So he sent me 2 blocks away from here. You can find a record of Roberto Goyeneche. And obviously, I bought this CD and start to listen that singer. And suddenly, I start to cry. I'm crying. Listening. Yes. And I said, okay, what things are happening inside of me? What kind of feeling I'm rebirthing in my body, in my mind, you know, a lot of things. And Roberto Goyeneche had a house in the neighborhood, so close, nearby home. And I remember that with my discman and my recorders, I was standing in front of the Roberto Goyeneche's house several times.
Did you meet
several
him?
Several times.
Did you meet him?
Yes.
No.
No, unfortunately, no. Just to watching this house and listening to the music, I don't know, was like a therapy, you know? Like a therapy. I don't know why, but a lot of memories were inside of me, getting right out of me and crying. So yeah, I don't know.
But let's have a look at Roberto Goyeneche. Amazing, very soulful singer. Who else would you consider an influence on you as a singer, as a tango singer?
Another tango singer that influenced me really is Raúl Verón.
Raúl Verón is
it's like he sings like jazz, you know?
Not like a jazz singer. Like a jazz singer. Let's go to him and let's talk about it in a moment.
Cafetín, donde lloran los hombres que saben del gusto que dejan los mares. Cafetín, y esa pena que amarga mirando los barcos volver a sus lares. Yo esperaba, porque siempre soñaba la paz de una aldea, sin hambre y sin vara. Cafetín, ya no tengo esperanza, ni sueños ni aldea para regresar. Por los viejos cafetines siempre rondan los recuerdos, y un compás de tango diente va a poner color al dolor del emigrante.
How do you feel about Verón? You talk about him as like a jazz influence singer.
Yes, for me so special this singer, because it's like an instrument. It's not like a singer. Maybe we can separate in between of two possibilities. A frontman, okay, a real frontman, okay, and a singer who are working like an instrument, okay, like a violin, for example. So for me, Raúl Verón is the last example, okay? Like violin, he are used in the very special dynamic with the orchestra dynamic. He tried to get like in the same layer that the orchestra, okay? Not over the orchestra. So for us, my function in the Santa Calavera is to be a frontman, but I'm trying to mix in between of the frontman and to work. So with a very sweet voice, with a very special scene, you know, with very special treatment about the melody, because the melody is just a melody. So if the singer sings the melody naturally, I think that can transmit more emotional the lyrics, you know. When we are working just like a frontman, a lot of things you need to do. In which way are you moving on the stage? If you are using the stand microphone, or the microphone is on your head and on your hands, if you are working or playing with the other musicians, with the orchestra, or you are just watching to the audience. So I think that's, for me, the best way is a mix in between.
Integrate and be a part of it.
Yes.
Can you give me a demonstration, or give us a demonstration, just using your voice, of how you would make the vocals unique for a dance audience that would be different from playing it as more of a performance or a streaming? Is there a difference?
Yes, the difference is for example, this is the first this is the instrumental way to sing, okay?
Tirado por la vida de errante bohemio, estoy Buenos Aires anclado en París, curtido de males, bandeado de premios, evoco desde este lejano país.
And the other way.
Tiro por la vida, errante bohemio, estoy Buenos Aires anclado en París, curtido de bandeado de apremios, evoco desde este lejano país. Contemplo la nieve que cae blandamente desde mi ventana.
I think that the dancers are looking for the two possibilities. Okay.
Yeah. I saw an interview with Alberto Castillo, in which he was talking about how his unique approach to the music was to be much more of a physical presence, and his staccato and legato was actually part of the rhythmic elements of the dance, like in the second example that you showed.
Yes, I think that this is the real explain to be clear about this. Okay, you bring Alberto Castillo that interview where they where he explained why he thinks in this way, because he knows that the dancers start to dance when he change your singing mode, okay? Because the first time Castillo was so clear, tira por la vida de rap, but after that he choose a way to think so social. Here, the newspaper sellers, okay? The
newspaper sellers.
Yes, in the street, they sell singing. I hear you.
Diario.
Yes, quinta, sexta, la razón. And the mouth is by side, okay? And the sound is so rare because nobody talk in this way. But in that time, yes, Buenos Aires was different.
Right.
So when Alberto Castillo test this kind of singing, okay, he starts to sing, cuatro compases bilongueros que tienen su razón con mi divino amor. And the dancers becoming crazy dancers. So he knows that, and he chose this kind of method to sing.
Let's talk about Alberto Podesta, because you also mentioned in our chats that he mm-hmm. was an influence. Let me play something and then let's talk about mm-hmm. it after.
Que tenía ella me mandaba las cartas con el primo. Entonces yo como cantaba en la radio, dice, yo te escucho siempre a tal hora en la radio, qué sé yo. Entonces cada vez que cantaba, yo cantaba esa canción. Solamente tú se llama, solamente tú.
Mucho tiempo después de alejarme, vuelvo al barrio que un día dejé, con el ansia de ver por su calle mis viejos amigos, el viejo café. En la noche tranquila, la oscura, hasta el aire parece decir, no te olvides que siempre fui tuya. Y sigo esperando que vuelvas a mí. En esta noche vuelvo a ser aquel muchacho soñador que supo amarte y con su verso te vendó sus penas. Hay una voz que me dice al oído, yo sé que has venido por ella que amable, que tristeza la vez. La soledad del arrabal, con sus casitas y los árboles que pintan sombra. Sentir que todo la nombra. Qué ganas enormes me da de llorar.
Podesta.
Incredible. This video. This video is a TV, this TV show was called Grandes Valores del Tango. I remember when I was a teenager, my father played this kind of TV shows and we started to fight. No, tango, no, please, no. I want to watch
MTV.
Yes, no MTV. That in that you remember Mario Baracus?
Oh yeah.
The Team A.
A team.
Yes, because here was Brigada A.
Yeah, the A team TV series.
Yes. So my father played this TV show, Tango TV show, for me was okay. No, please, Papa, no, please. But after that, Tango came to me and okay, never more lasted. Alberto Podestá is a very special singer. I meet him the last years. He works in a very special coffee here called Homero Manzi, who is the name of a composer, tango composer. Homero Manzi is a dinner tango show. And yes, I meet a few times in the bar of the corner of that restaurant, and we meet some things. I remember that when we, I said, Alberto, I'm working with another tango singer, and we record this song, La Pastora, and when we, he sent me, this is shit.
Oh, no.
But this is La Pastora from the Angelis, Dante Martel, yes, shit. Okay, I don't know why, but maybe he was old. Because he was old, but for me it was a surprise. Okay, Alberto Podestá sent me that this song is shit. I can understand nothing, but I think that Alberto Podestá was so special singer. You know that he sang with Franchini and Pontier. He sang with Miguel Caló.
Di Sarli. And Laurens, he sang with everybody. Laurens, Di Sarli.
So special orchestras, eh?
Yeah.
Because Franchini Pontier was very, very, very special orchestra. Yes, I think that Alberto Podestá, I took from here the color of the voice.
The color of the voice.
Tiempo después de alejarte. Yes, because I'm a tenor, okay. So for me, all the tango singers that sing in the tenor tessiture was special. But this is baritone singer, so for me was so special his sound. Is the real sound of the voice. So I took the way to get my low frequencies, you know?
The lower frequencies of the tenor.
To growing up my lower frequencies, yes. It was so fun to discover these kind of possibilities, yes.
We're almost running out of time here. I wish we could, well, maybe we'll do another one, but just to wrap up, what is the future of tango post-COVID? How are you preparing and how do you think the world should prepare for tango?
So difficult to define the future of tango around the world. You know that our activity was stopped by the governments around the world to dance cheek to cheek. It's so hard because obviously around the world a lot of tango communities that they are not vacunados. So you know, there are a lot of clandestine milongas here in Buenos Aires.
Right.
Yes, obviously. There are where the people are not using masks.
There's always a risk with that. You know, we had an outbreak in Hong Kong among the ballroom Latin community. And
yes.
As far as I know, no one within the tango community was affected because we took all sorts of precautions in the events that we had, including registering. We had, you know, people dancing with their known partners, wearing masks, you know, sanitized, changing clothes before going in, things like that. Doing everything that we could to mitigate or minimize the risks, and, you know, touch wood, we were safe so far. And now, at least in Hong Kong, there's a lockdown. So dancing is effectively banned for until whenever. But I think, you know, there is this idea that we need to really take precautions and find that, you know, balance between enjoying oneself and being safe.
Yes, I think that is so hard, you know, right here to get the people inside of home was so hard because you know that for us, it's not easy to sustain without work because people here, maybe a little percent, okay, yes, they could, but we have a lot of poor people.
Yeah.
Or people without work or people that, I don't know, have maybe six sons.
And so Buenos Aires, with the inflation and the unpredictability of the economic situation, it's an expensive city. It's not cheap at all.
Yes, we have a real devaluation, and all the things that you need to live are growing up. So that become so expensive.
Yeah.
Okay. For example, a liter of Coke before the quarantine, 50 pesos.
Right. Today, 50 pesos.
Yes.
Now it's today, 150. So the inflation has tripled.
Yes.
Well.
Yes.
Well, you're going to keep practicing. So you're going to keep teaching. You're going to be doing Zoom classes. You're going to be doing concerts as much as you can, streaming.
Yes, yes. I'm working on about musicality meetings to understand elements, tango elements, about melodies, about the orchestration. It's not a technical meeting. We just analyze all the orchestras that we are dancing in the milongas, like Bizarli, like Biashi, a lot of milongas that we can analyze. And after that, we can listen in different way. Because for example, in the orchestra, we have three layers happening all the time. The rhythm layer, the singer and the violins or the bandoneons playing all the main melody. So for us, it's not easy to listen the three layers at the same time, but we can develop our listening. So we are working with a group from Canada. I'm working with another group from the United Kingdom. And with people from Germany. So for me, it's so hard because the hours are so different.
Well, yeah, the time zones and everything like that. Like even this recording is a bit strange.
Yes.
Before you go, Ariel, it's Christmas time. Feliz Navidad. Thank you for sharing your insights. Could you give us one more song?
Yes, sure. I want to say thank you so much, right? Not for this moment. I want to say thank you for that moment that you allowed us in Hong Kong first.
I'll never forget it. And back to...
I never forget it also. No. It was so special for us. For us was so special. And I want to say thank you. And I remember a lot of people that are... working with you or maybe trying to Diabla D-Shape.
We had a great crew and a great team.
Yes. So I want to say thank you, all of you guys, because in this opportunity, I want to lost this opportunity. To say thank
Can you play us one more song?
Yes, sure.
And then we'll wrap it up. Thank you so much. Okay. Tell us the song. What's the song?
Is Anclado en París for all of the musicians that are looking down out of Buenos Aires. Okay. Tirado por la vida, errante bohemio, estoy Buenos Aires anclado en París, curtido de males, bandeado de aprecio, evoco desde este lejano país. Contemplo la nieve que cae blandamente desde mi ventana que da al bulevar, las luces rojizas de tonos murientes parecen pupilas de extraño mirar. Lejano Buenos Aires, qué lindo que has de estar, ya van para 10 años que me he visto zarpar. Aquí en este volmar, humor sentimental, yo siento que el recuerdo me clava su puñal.
Esa, gracias por todo, me ha encantado, ojalá que viéramonos pronto un día. Aguante, amigo. Vaya con Dios. Feliz Navidad.
Muchas gracias. Felicidades para todos ustedes.
Chao.